Hey, what's up, garden friends? Jeff here, Tropical Plant Party. How's everybody doing? Hope you're good. I am great. Time to toss together my first fall planter. Well, first of the year, that is. I, you know, do these pretty much every year. I have a small plastic barrel planter in front of me, and I'm going to be doing multiple planters throughout, like, the next couple of weeks. This first one I'm doing is going to be mostly perennials. I want to do that one first because, you know, they're perennials. They need more time to get themselves settled in before the fall and winter comes around and they have to deal with cooler temps. And I'm pretty sure just about everything that's going in here was in the video where I listed off a bunch of plants I like for fall containers, so should be a pretty short video. There's not a ton to say. Gonna get these potted up and then kind of talk about them a little bit. And just, it's gonna be very full. Just, it's fine. Don't worry about it. My eyes are bigger than my pots. I can't help it. Man, all done. That's a terrible angle. Okay, that's a little bit better. I've been fighting with the sun today, moving umbrellas around, trying to keep things in the shade so we can see what's going on. Just gonna go with the flow. This is the way things go sometimes when you're working outdoors, right? So I did end up making two different planters here, and that's because, I mean, it was just in the clip, but the explanation behind it is that, so this Rudbeckia, this is the Denver Daisy Rudbeckia. I'll go over all the plants here in just a second, but in my head, this was much shorter than it actually is. And I thought that would look nice over here in the foreground, but it really just didn't work. Then after looking at the Rudbeckia, I was just like, you know what? This is such an adorable plant. I would kind of like for it to be out on its own. Went ahead, drilled those holes, tossed it in the bucket, threw a lemon coral sedum in the front, and that's it. I debated putting more lemon coral sedums in there so that they would go all the way around the sides of the bucket, but it's just not necessary. They're such vigorous growers. It'll fill out around all those edges very quickly in no time on its own. I don't need to put more in there. And that made more room for me to go ahead and squeeze in this goldenrod. That was important to me. I'll talk about that in just a second. So let's go over the plants that are in here. Just about everything that's in this container was in that video, the plants for fall. I'm still gonna go over them briefly and talk about why I chose them. This very tall, beautiful plant in the back. This is the Helenium Bandera. The variety's called Mariachi. Has really cute button-like tiny little flowers on it. It's a nice upright perennial, hardy to zones 3, so fully hardy where I live. I'm in zone 6A, 6B, kind of right on the border there. That's important when working with containers, right? Want things to be extra hardy. We want them to be at least a zone, preferably 2 zones below where we are, just because, you know, they're exposed in a container, so they need to be extra hardy. This one gets 12 to 15 inches high, 15 to 18 inches wide, and it is a full sun plant. Everything that's in here is full sun. The ivy that's in the front, well, I mean, that one can kind of go in different directions. It's ivy, you know? It's ivy. That's a tough plant. And then right next to that helenium is a beautiful northern sea oat. Isn't that pretty? I love the little oats. It's a nice contrast to it. It's something that's kind of a nice change from just a typical fountain grass that's in a lot of fall planters. Northern sea oat plant, generally the spring through like mid to early summer foliage comes out a really nice chartreuse, vibrant green. Then it fades to just a normal green. And it sends up all of its little flowers and its little sea oats on there. They start off white, fade into a brown, which I think is fitting for fall. They kind of dry, they dangle. They add movement and texture. They're just pretty. Not really something I threw in like with any sort of intent other than it's just pretty. Otherwise, I was trying to be pretty pollinator forward with this planter. You can't really see it, but there is a milkweed tucked back there. It's a curacivaca. They're not hardy where I live, but I do like to throw the annual Asclepias, the milkweeds, and just about all my planters. So there is one back there. It'll come up a little bit higher, and the monarchs will be appreciative of that. Oh, the sea oats. Sorry, I probably got sidetracked there. These sea oats are hardy down to zone 4. They get 3 feet high, 2 feet wide, so obviously it's not going to be able to stay in this container for too terribly long. It'll get pretty big, and they like full sun. They're fairly low maintenance once they're established. That's the case for everything that's in this planter, actually. Everything I've chosen is pretty drought tolerant and easy to grow. Particularly this goldenrod. This is the little lemon goldenrod. It stays fairly small for a goldenrod. Only gets 18 inches by 18 inches. Hardy to zone 5. Again, full sun. Everything in here is full sun. They bloom spring and summer. What I like about this little lemon goldenrod, really all goldenrods, is they have a nice texture to them. They, you know, they do put out a lot of pollen, but that's fine. Pollinators love them. The flowers start off kind of a pretty lemony golden color. It's kind of hard to get it on camera because they're just going into flower. Old flowers are fading out, like you can see up top here. There's an old flower fading out. New buds are coming in back there behind the coreopsis. They'll open up a nice bright yellow and then turn to a sort of white color, like you see in the very center, and then they dry out to a brown. These can be cut off and deadheaded or left. I think it'll be fine either way. This time of year, it's not a big deal. Because if they end up just drying and staying on there, it's going to look fine. It's a fall planter. I like this goldenrod as an option for a perennial fall planter because it has a similar shape and texture to a celosia, but I mean, obviously nowhere near as colorful, right? Still really pretty, and it's going to come back every year. There's a celosia, not so much. In celosia, where I live, if we end up having a fall that is extremely wet or really a late summer that's really wet, they tend to just melt away. They don't like being sopping wet when we have heat spells. And the goldenrod's going to do a little bit better than a celosia would. Same thing over here with this coreopsis. This is the Lil Bang variety. It's called Red Elf. Fun name, very cute. Sounds like a rapper. I enjoy it. It's kind of in between flowers right now, so there's not really much to show. But again, this was in my video that I posted a few videos prior to this one with fall plants that I would be using this year. It was like kind of a list of most of them, not all of them, because, you know, keep buying more plants. But it has a great texture to it. It's a very low maintenance plant. They're pretty drought tolerant once they're established. This will only get 6 to 12 inches high, 12 to 18 inches wide, bloom summer and then into fall, and it's hardy, fully hardy in zone 5. Yeah, everything's full sun. It's a full sun plant too. Coreopsis is one that I enjoy growing. One, because I like the airy texture. I particularly like this Lil Bang because of the red flowers, which again, none of the flowers are really looking that great right now because it's in between blooms. The scarlet color of the flowers, the pollinators enjoy them. And when I put coreopsis in the ground, they die. I should say they get murdered. The rabbits just destroy them. So I can typically only do coreopsis in containers, so I was happy to be able to put this one in here. And in the front is a trailer. I just went ahead and tossed an ivy in there. It's not any type of special variety, just like a variegated assorted perennial ivy. Hardy to zones 4. I mean, if not more hardy, it's an ivy. They are so tough. It's just going to trail down the front. I had thought about putting an alyssum in here, but I can't find any right now. So that's part of the reason that I didn't do that. And I didn't want to go with an alyssum or even like a creeping Jenny. You know, I use those a lot. I like where they look coming over the fronts of these fall containers, or the barrel planters, I should say. But those are both plants that really like to be watered more frequently than anything else I have in here. Everything's different when it's in a pot as opposed to in the ground, but they are still going to be need to be watered fairly often, but not as often as something like I was mentioning, like an alyssum or a creeping Jenny, something like that. Ivy can take a decent amount of water, but it can also be pretty drought tolerant because it's ivy. It's just a really tough plant. So I just thought ivy would just keep it nice and simple. That was kind of the whole point here with this container, is simplicity. I know it's very crowded. I will next year have to kind of pull them apart and do some other things with them. I know I do plan on trying to keep the helenium that's in here in the back. I want that to stay in there for sure. And the coreopsis, everything else can be moved into the pollinator garden. The ivy can be trimmed and it'll be just fine like that. The Rudbeckia. Let's go ahead and call it like we see it. Little bit wonky, right? We've had a lot of storms lately. A palm tree fell down on this one. So she's recovering. When I can find some little stakes to put in here, I will use those to go ahead and prop that plant up and get all that foliage standing back upright. I can't find any stakes right now. Yeah, this is the Denver Daisy Rudbeckia. Blooms spring, summer, and fall. It's a mounting perennial. Full sun, hardy zones 5 and up, 18 to 28 inches high by 10 to 25 inches wide. The pollinators like it, so that's one of the reasons that I wanted to make sure it would have a nice area to go ahead and fill out, because like I just said, 10 to 25 inches wide, this plant will, maybe not this year, but it will fill out the entire top of this bucket and probably need to actually be moved into the ground really next year. We'll just have to wait and see in the springtime how full everything gets. Oh yeah. And then the lemon coral sedum. So not a perennial where I live. They're hardy zone 7 and up. I'm in 6A, 6B, kind of right on the line. So I just put it in there because I think it's pretty. I think the foliage has a nice contrast to it. It's low maintenance and simple. And I have like 10 of them laying around ready to go into planters. So I thought, why not? Just go ahead and put something in the front. I do think it would look just fine without anything in there if the plant were standing upright, how it should be. It's a little wonky. So I think having the sedum in there helps a little bit. That's everything, nothing complicated. I did add some Espoma Biotone starter into the top of the soil for both of these and work that in a little bit. Help get nice healthy roots going. In the winter time, I will move these to a sheltered location. They may even get just thrown inside a pile of mulch that I have a bunch of banana trees. Those get a lot of mulch on them, so sometimes I'll throw my containers in there. And they will still need to be watered at least once a month, like snow, ice, doesn't matter. They're getting water dumped on top of them just to keep them going. And yes, I know it's full. Like I said, this year, not a big deal. It's late August, so it's not going to do too terribly much this year. Next year, I'll have to pull and do some rearranging, which I'm fine with, because at least they come back. A little bit more utility out of these than with annuals. I'm going to be using plenty of annuals in my other videos, don't get me wrong. But I really want to keep this one very pollinator forward, and I've noticed that the bees and hummingbirds and butterflies, I mean, mostly bees and butterflies, hummingbirds haven't paid too much attention to these, but they kind of check them out sometimes. They really seem to appreciate these plants, so that's kind of what the theme here was. Low maintenance, pollinators, perennial. Oh, and with a lot of these plants that are in here being drought tolerant, and really plants that you find where I live in Missouri, like the coreopsis, the helenium, that goldenrod, they're typically in fields and like the outskirts of prairies and whatnot, places where the soil drains fairly quickly and dries out a lot. Now, when it gets wet, it can stay pretty wet because it's pretty clayey around that area. Is that a word? That being said, I did make sure to put some gritty sand, more like a tiny gravel, in that soil mix just to make sure it drains a little bit more sharply. I don't want this to stay too wet because fall can be a little bit weird around here. I don't know what the weather is going to be like if it ends up being really, really wet, which it has been so far, but that plus really hot temperatures like over 85 into the 90s. Then that could be a problem for some of these plants that are in here. So the soil needs to drain quickly and dry quickly. What are some of your favorite perennials to use for your fall containers or fall gardening? I really like coneflowers. I used some last year. They just don't do great for me as far as coming back the next year. I think they just get a little bit too wet in the wintertime and they tend to just rot away on me. But I used a bunch last year and I love them. And I planted some coneflowers in my pollinator garden this year. They're not doing much just yet because that's a whole long story. I took my other pots and they basically didn't have roots on them, so that's always fun when that happens, right? But yeah, comment down below. What are some of your favorite plants? And just say hi. I love talking to everybody. I have all my social media linked down below. I use Instagram way more than anything else. I'll be posting updates of things on there as things progress and change and bloom and flower. That's the best place to follow me. And if you haven't already and you'd like to, you can give the video a thumbs up. I'd appreciate it. It makes a big difference for the videos and for the channel, so thank you. And subscribe as well and hit that notification bell, upload multiple times a week. And that way you know when new videos come out. And I hope everybody's doing well, having a great day, great life, everything's just going beautifully for you. And as always, and most importantly, everybody, keep on growing. Bye-bye.